So, Hare Krishna. So, as I was saying, we are in a very interesting place in Bhagavad Gita. We have finished actually 9 chapters and we're reading 10th chapter. Remember, Bhagavad Gita has 18 chapters. The first 6 chapters are more knowledge that Krishna is giving to Arjun, knowledge as in knowledge about who we are. So, we are the spirit soul, we are not the body, we are the soul. We are part and parcel of Krishna. We are eternal servants of Krishna. He gives us the characteristics of soul in second chapter, that a soul cannot die, it does not kill, it does not dissolve, it cannot be burnt, it cannot be hurt by any weapons, right? It cannot be burnt by fire. It cannot get wet with water. It is very minute, but it belongs to the original super soul. And super soul is the Paramatma living inside us. So Krishna is living as Paramatma inside all of us, and we are part and parcel of that Supreme Lord Krishna. So he gives us this basic knowledge in the initial few chapters. In the third chapter, he tells us the importance of yajnas or sacrifices, and then we come to know that the recommended yajna or the sacrifice for this Kaliyuga is the japa or chanting of the holy name. That's why we were glorifying the holy name just now. So many yajnas are recommended for different ages. Like for Satyug, the yajna that was recommended was to just sit in dhyan. People will go to forest and give up their possessions and families, and they'll just sit in dhyan in or meditation in forest. And Treta Yug, the yajna that was recommended was, does anybody know? Fire sacrifices, right? That is like offering oblations in the fire and purify ourselves like that. So you please various deities, Brahmaji, demigods, you do yajnas for the well-being of other living entities, animals, and for your ancestors. So different kind of yajnas. Does anyone know what is the yajna recommended for Dwapar Yug? Does Navya know? Take a guess. So we already covered dhyan, we already covered fire sacrifices. So the Dwapar Yug would be deity worship, right? So the Vigraha Seva, right? To serve the Vigraha, the lotus feet of the Lord in the form of a deity worship. And so for the Kaliyuga, the recommended yajna is the chanting of the holy name. And then in fourth chapter, Krishna talked about the importance of guru, how one should accept, one should learn this knowledge. This knowledge has been coming down from Krishna himself and then was given to Brahma, Lord Brahma, then from Lord Brahma to Narad Muni, and in succession like that, knowledge has been coming, and it got broken. The chain of succession of knowledge got broken in the middle. So Krishna came again to give us this knowledge 5,000 years back in form of Bhagavad Gita, right? In fifth chapter, Krishna talks to us about Karma Yoga or action in Krishna consciousness, that you keep Krishna in the center of all of your activities. Whether you're taking care of your family, Krishna is in the center. Whether you're doing a job, Krishna is in the center. So you're not doing it for your sense gratification. You're not doing it for money. You're not doing it for name, fame, reputation, glorifications, followers, wealth, things like that. Those are all material things and they're very temporary and go away. You're doing it for Krishna. Everything you do, Krishna says, Yat karoshi yad ashnasi, yad juhoshi yad tapasasi kaunteya tat kurushva madarpanam. That whatever you do, you offer to me. So when you do anything for Krishna, it becomes spiritual. It doesn't say a material job. Then that particular same job becomes spiritual. For example, you're cooking at home. Cook for Krishna. Don't cook, oh, I have to cook so that everybody will give me, will say, oh, my food is so tasty. I'll get so many applause. I'll get, people will give me wah wahi, or all because I have to feed my family. No, even that is material. Do it for Krishna, that I am making prasad for Krishna. So if I'm making it for, let's say you're making let's say Joe Biden comes to your home, right? You say, oh, President of America has come to my home. I have to satisfy him. Then you would make such a delicious meal for him, right? Similarly, if you're cooking for Krishna, think about, okay, this is the Lord of the Supreme, this is the Supreme Lord of the whole world. This is not just President of America who can change every few years. This is Supreme Lord of the whole world. I'm coming from him. I'm part and parcel of him. He's eternal. This is where I have to go back. I need his mercy. So I want to satisfy him. So if you make food in that consciousness, the same food becomes prasadam. So anything material can become spiritual when we do it for Krishna. So that is what he taught in fifth chapter, that you do action in Krishna consciousness by keeping Krishna in center, changing your consciousness of work, changing the intention of your work, you can make everything Krishna conscious. And then in sixth chapter, he talks about controlling the mind, how one should control our mind, because mind is a big distractor. It is what will stop you from focusing on Krishna. It will, what will say, for example, you're sitting here, mind will tell you, why are you sitting here? This is so boring. Why are you reading Bhagavad Gita? You're so young. You don't need to read Bhagavad Gita. You need to go to a bar and have some few drinks. You need to hang out with your friends and you need to just play with them. You're so young. Why should you do this? I worked so hard the whole week. Now I deserve some, I need to watch some movies online. So mind will tell you, mind will make excuses for you. It is trying to gratify the senses. Mind is a slave of senses. So it is trying to gratify those senses and it will make those excuses for you. So Krishna teaches in sixth chapter about Dhyan Yoga, controlling your mind. And then from seventh chapter, all the devotional aspects come. So from seventh to 12th chapter is the considered the essence of Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna is giving all his very intimate knowledge. He is giving knowledge about himself, about how to come back to him. So far he was just giving dry knowledge, which is good for conducting a life, which will give you peace of mind, stress-free, anxiety-free life, fine. But then you come to the next level, you understand your relationship with Krishna and you realize I have to go back to him. So then he tells you how to go back to him. So the sixth chapter finishes with the verse where he says that out of all the yogis, I care for the people that do my bhajan. So he says, yoginam api sarvesham madgatin antar atmana shraddhavan bhajte yomam. Same yuktat momata, that the one who worships me with faith, with shraddha, that is the one is most dearest to me. That type of yogi is most dearest to me. So he gave knowledge of all the various yogas. And then he says the bhakti yogi, the one who serves me in devotion, who does my bhajan, bhajte yomam, that person is most dearest to me. So that is where he finished the sixth chapter. And now we've moved to bhakti yoga. From seventh to 12th chapter, he gives the knowledge of his devotional service. 12th chapter is actually called devotional service. So he's still building up to the actual devotional service up till 12th chapter. And in 8th chapter, in 7th chapter, he tells us about himself a little, various kind of people that approach him in different mood, people that do not want to approach him. And in 8th chapter, he talks about attaining the supreme, like how one can attain him, with what consciousness one should leave the body, right? So 8th chapter, he tells us how to leave your body. And 9th chapter, he tells us about how this, very, very intimate details, actually, he has given in 9th chapter. He gives about knowledge about how he will reciprocate to a person that is surrendering to him. So he says, if you surrender to me, I will take care of all that you lack and carry what you lack and preserve what you have. And I will take care of you even if you have a fall down. He makes a lot of promises in 9th chapter. So those of you who have not read 9th chapter, it is a chapter that gives you so much faith to follow this process, because Krishna personally is making so many promises in that chapter. And then we come to 10th chapter, where finally Arjun realizes that this is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Well, I was thinking this is my friend. No, this is not my friend. This is Supreme Personality of Godhead. So I need to know about him. So he says, please tell me all your opulences, all your mystic powers. Who are you? I thought you were my friend. Please tell me all about you. So then Krishna starts talking about his opulences or vibhuti. So this chapter is called Vibhuti Yoga, or opulences of the absolute. Krishna is called absolute truth because he's the only thing that is absolute. Everything else is very relative. Things can change around us, right? Our situations can change. People around us can change. Relationships can change. Circumstances, jobs, where we live, how much money we have. Everything can change. Everything is very relative. But the only thing that is absolute, the absolute truth, is Krishna. So that is called opulences of the absolute. So I just wanted to give a little background for because I know that not everybody was here with us from the beginning. And let's just read a few shlokas from 10th chapter, and that will bring us to the stories then. So we had finished till 25th shloka, 10.25. And this website is called Veda Base. So those of you who are interested in reading any books like Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, so many small books, this is the resource for that. So let's read from 26. 25th is the one where we stopped, where Krishna says that I am the Bhrigu among great sages, among Maharishis, I am Rishi Bhrigu. Among the various transcendental sounds, I am the sound of Om. Among the yagyas, I am the Japa Yagya. Among the things that do not move, immovable things, I am the Himalaya. So he's giving his opulences, how he is the best among everything. He is the topmost. I think my internet is not doing so well. That's why it's a little slow. So please bear with me. Okay, so we'll a little bit go quickly in these next few verses. As we understood before, that these are opulences of Krishna, so they are the best thing in any category. They are the ones that are representative of Krishna. So not much to discuss here. So I'll recite and let's follow. 10.26. Ashwatha sarva vrikshanam.
Ashwatha sarva vrikshanam.
Devrishinam cha narada. Gandharvanam chitrartha.
Gandharvanam chitrartha.
Siddhanam kapilo muni.
Siddhanam kapilo muni.
Okay. Would someone like to read this translation?
I can do it, Mataji.
Yes, please.
Of all the trees, I am the banyan tree, and of all the sages among the demigods, I am the Narad. Of all the Gandharvas, I am the Chitrartha, and among perfected things, I am the sage Kapila. Haribol.
Haribol. Thank you, Mataji, for reading. So this is basically saying, of all the trees, I am banyan tree. Ashwatha is also called banyan tree. Actually, in 15th chapter, the first shloka talks about this banyan tree. Krishna gives a very beautiful analogy later on, how there is this banyan tree, there is an upside down banyan tree. And the roots, so you know, we always, so imagine that you look in a pond and there is a, you see a reflection of the tree, right? If you throw pebbles into it, the reflection will move, right? So that is how the material world is. Material world is nothing but the reflection of the spiritual world. So that reflection is what? It is just, it is an illusion, right? It is not something substantial. Like you cannot touch it. You cannot eat fruit from there. You cannot climb on it. Can you? No. So that tree is just a reflection in the water. But that is how the nature of this material world. It is just a reflection of the original spiritual world in the water. And we are struggling very hard to get fruits from that tree, to climb that tree, to make ourselves on the topmost branch, to get on the topmost branch. But whenever somebody throws just a little pebble on that water, everything shakes, our whole world shakes, right? Everything moves. Somebody said something to me and we are distracted and destroyed by that for like few days, right? I am going to take revenge because somebody did this to me. So what are that people doing? Just throwing some pebbles. But that is the nature of this material world. Whereas the actual original tree is so strong, so many winds come and it will not fall down. So many branches, you know, it gives you ripe fruits. You can climb on it. You can hang a swing on it and swing with it. You can do so many things. It is strong, right? It is tolerant. Whenever you have to give an example of something that is tolerant, you talk about a tree that is withstanding all the storms and winds, right? Because it is such a big, thick trunk. But what we are looking at, what we are focused on is the reflection. So we have to change. We have to stop looking at the reflection and look at the real thing. The real thing is what will bear the fruits. The real thing is what will tolerate. The real thing is what will give us joy. So banyan tree, Krishna gives later on this beautiful analogy of how there is this upside down banyan tree. And we will come to that in 15th chapter. But banyan tree is considered considered the topmost. You see so many banyan trees. I'm not sure if you've gone to any botanical garden. They say, oh, this banyan tree is so many thousands of years old because it withstands. It develops its roots every which way under the earth and can stand for a long, long, like for many, many years. So that is why Krishna is comparing to the in that category among trees. He says, I am the banyan tree, Ashwattha. Dev Rishi Naam Cha Narada. So there are many Dev Rishis, but the one that is most dear to Krishna and most, and actually one of our acharyas is Dev Rishi Narad. So you know that the knowledge was given by Krishna to Brahmaji and from Brahmaji to Narad Muni. And Narad Muni goes around everywhere giving this knowledge to all the other lokas and planets. He's spreading this knowledge everywhere. If you think about so many devotees that Narad Muni has initiated, starting from anybody, Prahlad Maharaj, Dhruv Maharaj. Can anybody name any other disciples of Narad Muni? One very big disciple whose appearance day was celebrated yesterday.
Yasdev?
Yeah. So yesterday was Guru Purnima, right? Guru Purnima is basically the appearance day of our Guru, Vyasdev, who has written all the Vedas, Vedantas, who has compiled all the knowledge into Srimad Bhagavatam, and Bhagavad Gita was compiled as part of Mahabharata. He compiled all our Vedas and all the knowledge. And so who gave him the knowledge? Narad Muni. So Narad Muni is movies and all this show, Narad Muni is just saying Narayan, Narayan. He's shown as this funny character. But no, Narad Muni's position is very, very exalted. If one takes shelter of the lotus feet of Narad Muni, you can, you know, he perfected his life in one life, not like us. We are wasting so many lives. So one takes shelter of lotus feet of Narad Muni, one can achieve pure devotional service. So he says, among the Dev Rishis, I am Narada. Okay, so, and actually the first canto of Bhagavatam, the first few chapters that those of you that have been reading, I know Anita Mataji has been reading, it talks about the previous life of Narad Muni, how Narad Muni came into devotional service. So how Narad Muni gave the knowledge to Vyasdev. We know that how he gave knowledge to Prahlad Maharaj while Prahlad Maharaj was still in the womb of Kayadu. How Narad Muni gave instructions to Dhruv Maharaj when he was in the forest, separated from his family. So there is a lot to talk about Narad Muni. I know Anita Mataji is going to mention very quickly later on, right? He's one of the 12 Mahajans also. So people that have perfected the Bhagavad Dharma and have applied it perfectly, whose footsteps we should follow. He's one of those. Gandharva Naam Chitraratha. So Gandharvas are those creatures, or I should say those entities. So just like human beings are one kind of species, right? Animals is some different species, plants are different. Similarly, and then there are demons. Similarly, there are many, many different species that live on different planets. Gandharvas are like superior beings compared to humans. They are always singing and dancing that is their expertise of singing and dancing. Actually, Narad Muni is also one of the Gandharvas. That is why he's always singing and glorifying Krishna everywhere in different planets. So among Gandharvas, Krishna says, I'm Chitraratha. So Chitraratha is one of the Gandharvas who's singing and dancing for the pleasure of Krishna. So he says, among Gandharvas, I'm Chitraratha. Siddhanam. Siddhanam means people that are Siddh Purush or perfected beings. Among the perfected beings, I'm Kapilomuni. Now there is Lord Kapila, whose story is mentioned in, again, Srimad Bhagavatam. Kapil Muni is the one who gave all the knowledge of Sankhya Yoga. Sankhya Yoga is basically the knowledge of a spirit soul, how small the spirit soul is, what are the characteristics of a spirit soul. All that knowledge is called Sankhya Yoga, and that was given by Lord Kapila. And his story comes in Srimad Bhagavatam, how he gave instructions to Devahuti, his mother. So actually those prayers are very popular among devotees, Devahuti's prayers to Lord Kapila, to her own son. she got all the knowledge from her own son Kapil Muni. Those Devahuti prayers will sometime read Srimad Bhagavatam. But Kapila Muni is one of the perfected beings. And so Krishna says, among the six Purushas, among the perfected Purushas, perfected beings, I am Kapila Muni. Would anybody like to add anything, share anything? Or any questions? Prinka Madhaji, are you following? Is it too hard?
I've been able to follow so far. So hopefully even further. So far it's been good.
Thank you so much. So this is the chapter I just wanted to show in third canto, 33 chapter, activities of Kapila Muni will come. How Devahuti, the mother of Lord Kapila, wife of Kardam Muni, will take, how she got freed from all ignorance and got transcendental knowledge from Kapila Muni. She offered her obeisances unto the Lord, the author of the basic principles of the Sankhya system of philosophy, which is the background of liberation, and she satisfied him with the following verses of prayer. And then the prayers of Devahuti will start. So he gave her the knowledge, and then how she prayed to him. So that is the Kapila Muni here Krishna is talking about. So if everybody's okay, we'll keep moving a little. And we're coming to the part where Krishna will mention different things that come out of the churning of the ocean. So we'll do that story. Okay, so 10.27. Ucchai Shravasam Ashwanam. एरावतं गजेन्द्राणाम् नराणां च नराधिपाम् So here Krishna says that among the horses, Ashwa is horse in Sanskrit, Ashwa is horse. Among the Ashwas or Ashwanam, among the horses, I am Uchchaishrava. Uchchaishrava is one of the glorious horses, horse that came out during the churning of the ocean. When so you see here in translation, I'm sorry, somebody had to read the translation. Aman, would you like to read?
Yes, Mataji. Of horses, know me to be Uchchaishrava, produced during the churning of the ocean for nectar. Of lordly elephants, I am Airavata, and among men, I am the monarch.
Okay, so he says that among the Ashwas or horses, I'm Uchchaishrava, that was produced during the... So when we'll talk about the story, Puja Mataji is going to recite, tell us the story. But Samudra Manthan Leela, or when the ocean was churned, one of the things that came out was this horse, Uchchaishrava. Many, many different things came out. Elephant, horse, cow, right? So many different things, some jewels, poison was the first thing that came out, right? This, yes. And then Lakshmi Devi, right? Moon. So many things came out. Vidhi Mam Amritodbhavam. So here he's just saying that it was produced during the churning of the ocean for the nectar. And that was the whole purpose of churning of the ocean was to get nectar, right? Amrit, for the Amrit Udbhavam. For the production of the nectar, the ocean was churned. And during that, this horse came out. Among all the horses, I'm that horse. Among Gajendras, Gajendraman meaning the king of the elephants. So among various kings, lordly elephants. So there may be many kings of the elephants. Among those kings of the elephants, I'm Airavat. Airavat is the horse of Lord Indra. So when Airavat came out of the churning of ocean, who took it? Lord Indra took it. So this is Lord Indra, who's basically Lord Indra is Devendra, right? He's the king of Devas. Indra typically means king. So Gajendra, Gaj plus Indra, Gajendra, king of Gajas, king of Devas, Devendra is Lord Indra. So who took that horse? Airavat. Airavat was taken by Lord Indra. Nara namcha Naradipam. And among the kings or monarchs, Naradipam, Naradhi palm means, so adhin typically means below somebody. Naras are under whom? The king. So who is ruling the Naras? The king. So that is why king is called Naradhipa. So among the Naras, I'm king. Among the human beings, I'm king. So who is most glorified among all the human beings? We always glorify the leader, right? We always glorify, like, okay, if you're talking about US, you're talking about the president. If you're talking about India, you're talking about the prime minister of the country, right? That person represents that nation, right? We say, okay, Narendra Modi represents India. So imagine a whole country is being represented by that one person. That is why we say our leader should be a very godly, person who has good, strong moral ethics and can be a strong leader, right? Because that person is going to represent this whole country. He's going to lead this whole country. That person can either lead the country towards devastation or he can take that country towards success. Right? He can pollute the consciousness of either the whole country or he can uplift the consciousness of the whole country, right? With his what he says, how he acts. Because yadyada charti shreshtas tattad evate rujana. However, the successful people behave, the other people will follow in that manner. That is why so much responsibility is given to the leaders, to the celebrities, to the, like in our country, in India, cricket stars are given responsibility. They have, everybody that is looked up on should behave in a very, such a fashion that would uplift the followers, right? Because common men are going to follow them. So who are we following? We're following the king. So Krishna says, among the human beings, I am the king, meaning that the king is the representative of all the people. So a king has to be a very Krishna conscious, God conscious person. If a king, if the leader is not godly, if they do not have these godly qualities, if they do not, if they're not representative of Krishna, then such. So today's kings are actually not, today's leaders are actually not really representatives of Krishna. Sorry to say, but that is a sad state of affairs. But a king has to be representative of Krishna. Those kings Krishna is talking about. When he says, I am the king, he's not talking about anybody. He's talking about people that have chosen to be his representative. So when a king considers himself the representative of Krishna, then he cannot do anything wrong. He will, like Yudhishthir Maharaj, Parikshit Maharaj, right? We have to take examples from scriptures because I cannot think of modern day leaders. But in our scriptures, there are so many examples of great kings who led the way. Lord Ram, that is why, remember Shubhilas Prabhu's talk, he said, how will Ram Rajya come? Lord Ram was so glorious. He was the Maryada Purushottam. And that is why there was Ram Rajya. But we want Ram Rajya, but our leaders are not Lord Ram. So unless the leaders, the kings, are representatives of God, they cannot be Ram Rajya. So this is what I wanted to share in this one. Anybody has any questions or any comments, realizations, please share. Should we hear the story of churning of ocean from Pooja Mataji?
Yes, I was thinking the same thing. Okay. Should we hear the story right now?
Okay. Yeah, we can. So this is the story of Samudra Manthan. Pooja Mataji, would you like to tell us the story? Yes. Hey, Hari Bol, thank you.
Hare Krishna, everyone. I'm telling the story of churning of the milk ocean. After Lord Shiva drank all the poisons, both demigod and the demons being very pleased and began to churn the ocean with renewed vigor. As a result of this churning, there appeared a cow known as Surbhi cow or Kamdhenu cow. King Parikshit, who are completely aware of all ritualistic ceremony, took the charge of cow. Thereafter, a horse named Uchaisrava appeared, which was as white as moon, and Bali Maharaj possesses this horse. As a Next result of churning, the king of elephant, Airavat, was generated. This elephant was white with its four tusks. It defied glories of Kailas, the glories award the Lord award of Lord Shiva. Thereafter, eight elephants which could go in any direction were generated. They were headed by Ravana, and eight sea elephants headed by Abramu were also generated. Thereafter, celebrated gems Kaustubha Mani and Padmaraga Mani were generated. Lord Vishnu, to decorate his chest, desired to possess them. Generated next was Parijat flower, which decorates the celestial planets. The Parijat fulfills the desire of everyone. Next, there appeared the apsaras. The apsaras moves very slowly in an attractive way that bewilders the inhabitants of the heavenly planet. Then there appeared goddess of fortune Rama, Lakshmi Maharani, who absolutely dedicated to being enjoyed by Supreme Personality of Godhead. Everyone, including demigods, demons, and human beings, desired her. They were attracted because she is the source of all opulences. Indra brought suitable sitting place for her. All the rivers of sacred water, such as Ganges, Yamuna, personified themselves and brought pure water for her. The great sages performed the wedding ceremony of the goddess of fortune. The Gandharvas chanted all the auspicious Vedic mantras. The ocean supplied the yellow silken garments for her. Varuna presented flower garland surrounded by bumblebees. All the demigods, along with Prajapatis and their descendants, being blessed by Lakshmi's glance upon them, were immediately enriched with good behavior and transcendental qualities. Because being neglected by goddess of fortune, the demons and rakshas were depressed and bewildered and frustrated, and thus become shameless. Next appeared is Baruni, the lotus-eyed goddess who controlled drunkard with permission of Supreme Personality of Godhead. The demons headed by Bali Maharaj took possession of this young girl. Thereafter, while the son of Kasyap, both demons and demigods were engaged in churning of a very wonderful Churning and a very wonderful male appeared. He was dressed in yellow garments and wore brightly polished earring. His chest was very broad. His body has all good features, and he was strong and stout like lion. In his hand, he carried a jug filled to top with nectar. This person was Dhanvantri, a plenary person of Lord Vishnu. He was very convergent in science and medicine, and as one of the demigods, he was permitted to take a share in the sacrifices. Upon seeing Dhanvantri carrying a jug of nectar, the demons desiring the jug and its contained immediately snatched away by force. When jug carried off by demons, the demigods were morose. Thus, they sought shelter at lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari. The God said, by my own energy, I shall bewilder the demons by creating a quarrel among them. A quarrel among them arose over who would get the nectar first. Each of them said, you can't drink it first, I must drink it first. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, who can counteract any unfavorable situation, then assumed the form of an extremely beautiful woman. This incarnation is of woman is Mohini Murti, was most pleasing to mind. Every part of her body was beautifully situated and equally decorated. Because of movement of her eyebrows, as she smiled with shyness and glanced over demons, all the demons were saturated with lusty desires, and every one of them desires to possess her. After that, demons said, all of us, both demons and demigods, have been born from same father Kasyapa, and thus we are brothers. Therefore, we request you to settle our dispute and divide the nectar equally among us. The Supreme Personality of Godhead in the form of Mohini smiled and spoke in attractive words. She said, my dear demons, if you accept whatever I may do, whether the honest and dishonest, then I can take responsibility for dividing and dividing the nectar among you. Demons agreed to accept her decision. Demons by nature crook like snake. Therefore, to distribute a share of nectar to them was not at all feasible, since this would be as dangerous as supplying milk to snakes. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Mohini, arranged separate line of sitting places and seated them according to their positions. Taking nectar in her hands, she first approached demons and satisfied them with sweet words. Then she administered nectar to demigods who were sitting at the distant places to make them free from invalidity, old age, and health and death. Since the demons had promised to accept whatever the woman did, whether the just or unjust, now to keep this promise to show their equilibrium, they are afraid of disturbing their relationship with her. Rahu, the demon who causes eclipse of sun and moon, covered himself in dress of demigod and drank the nectar. The moon and sun, because permanent anti-moisty towards Rahu, understood the situation, and Rahu were detected. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, by using his disc, at once cut off Rahu's head. When Rahu's head was severed from her body, the body being untouched by nectar could not survive. Rahu's head, however, touched by nectar, remained immortal. Thus, Lord Brahma accepted Rahu's head as one of the planets. Since Rahu is eternal enemy of sun and moon, he always tries to attack them on the night of full moon and dark moon. The place, the time, the cause and the purpose, the activity and the ambition were all the same for both demons and the demigods. But demigods achieved one result and demons achieved another. Because demigods are always under the shelter of the dust of the Lord's lotus feet, they could very easily drink the nectar and get its result. However, demons, not having shelter at lotus feet of God, was unable to achieve the result they desired. Thank you.
Rebold, thank you.
Rebold.
Very nice. You're reading from Bhagavatam?
Yes, Mataji.
Achha. Yeah, Bhagavatam, 8th canto has the whole story of the churning of the milk ocean. Those of you that want to read, I'll just show here. See, the whole story is here, the churning of the milk ocean, what came out and what happened. And then I think Pooja Mataji also read the next next one about the distribution when Mohini Murti, when Lord incarnates as Mohini Murti and then distributes the nectar. So let's see, did everybody understand the story? Any questions from Pooja Mataji? What was going on there? Has everybody heard this story before? Or was this anybody's first time? So basically here, one of the things I wanted to mention is how this all started was that there was a lot of fights going on between demons and demigods, right? For some reason, the demigods were losing because they were, I believe they were cursed by Durvasa Muni, and they had lost their powers and they were losing to demons a lot. So they approached Lord Vishnu and said, oh, you know, we are losing to demons. What can we do so that we can, become immortal, or, we want to be able to have more power over them. So Vishnu gave them the solution that if you churn the Kshir Sagar, the ocean of the milk, Kshir Sagar, which is milk ocean where Vishnu lays down, if you churn that ocean, then that will give you the nectar. And if you drink that nectar, you will become immortal and demons won't be able to harm you anymore, right? Everybody is looking for nectar, right? Elixir of life where one can become immortal. So then they started this process of churning. They alone couldn't churn. So demons also started churning with them. Is that right, Narada Prabhu?
Yes, they could, because one, there is a huge thing that is going to be needed. So they asked Lord Vishnu that how can we churn the ocean? So then Mount Meru was suggested.
Not Mandrachal Mountain.
Mandrachal Mountain was suggested. And then they need like something to rest the mountain on to churn it. So for that, Lord took the form of Kurma Avatar, the first of the Dash Avatar. So Kurma Avatar came and rested the Mandrachal Mountain on its back for the churning.
So there is the tortoise, the Kurma, right? On that top is the mountain. And then they needed a
rope to move it. So then, Navya, would you like to tell what was the rope? What acted as the rope?
Vasuki.
Yeah. Vasuki. Vasuki is the king of all the snakes. So Vasuki was used as the rope. So mountain and then the rope, and Kurma Avatar is at the base of the mountain. And so they're churning. And obviously, whenever you churn, just like in our real life, right? If we are like right now, what we are doing, we're churning ourselves. The first thing that will go away is the poison. The halahal wish came out. So the first thing when we start churning our senses and mind in the service of Krishna, the first thing that will go away is all the anarthas, all the anger, the greed, lust, pride, illusion, right? Kaam, krodh, lo, moh, mad, matsarya, 6 big anarthas, and then all the small ones, they'll start going away. But when the poison came out, it would destroy the whole material, whole cosmic creation. So all the demons and demigods were worried what would happen to all this poison that came out of this Samudra Manthan. So who do you think stepped up to the task of handling it? Yes, Vinita.
Lord Shiva.
Lord Shiva, yeah. He's the supreme Vaishnava. Vaishnava naam yatha shambhu, right? So so he's the supreme. He's one of the pure devotees of Krishna. So he stepped up to the task. I'll take care of the poison. So he drank that poison and held it in his throat and is now called Neelkantha. And, the Vaishnavas carry so much nectar in their own throat. They're chanting the names of Lord Hari all the time. He's in his meditation chanting the name of Lord Hari all the time, that poison was not could not affect him at all. Lord Shiva is very very pure. That poison cannot affect him like that. So poison came out, and then all the things that Puja Mataji mentioned, the horse Uchchaishrava, the elephant Airavat, Kaustubh jewel, that is mark of Lord Vishnu, he bears it on his chest, Lakshmi Devi, who everybody wanted, but she is the eternal consort of Lord Vishnu. So she, you know, we all want Lakshmi, everybody wants money, everybody wants Lakshmi Devi to bless you, but Lakshmi Devi is the eternal consort of Lord Vishnu. So unless you have Lord Hari in your house, unless you have Lord Hari in your heart and your actions and everywhere, she will not stay for very long. So those of you that want Lord Lakshmi to come to your house, you have to invite her husband, only then she will stay. So she's a pious lady, she will not stay without her husband in another person's house. So that's another motivation to start approaching Supreme Personality of Godhead if you're interested in his wife. So yes, everybody else, demons and demigods also wanted her, just like we do. We pray to Lord Lakshmi on Diwali, right? Nobody cares about Lord Ram came back. No, nobody cares about that. We want Lakshmi and Ganesh to give us auspiciousness and money. So let's pray to two of them that are the worshipable deities of those opulences. Let's just have the opulence. Who cares about the source? So, they also wanted her. But obviously she went with Lord Vishnu. And then came so many other things, small other things like that came out were various apsaras, the kalpvriksh, the desire tree came out. And actually in our association, we always say that the Vaishnavas, the devotees of the Lord, are the desire fulfilling tree. We say, right, vancha kalptaru bhyascha, they are the kalptaru. They are the tree that can fulfill the desires of any living entity. So just like Prahlad Maharaj was teaching to his friends, just like we read in this song, that a true guru, friend, wife, husband, or mother, father is the one who will take care of their dependents and get them out of the spiritual world. But Vaishnavas are so merciful that they don't only take care of their dependents, they want to take care of the whole world. So that is why Shubhilas Prabhu came and did this Sankirtan festival standing on the roadside. These are highly amazing, you know, professional, intelligent people that are standing on the roadside distributing Harinam. So Vaishnavas like him and so many others are so merciful that they are giving Harinam to everybody, not only just their dependents. So in this way, kalpvriksh, they are like kalpvriksh, they are desire-fulfilling tree, and the only true desire to have is to get out of this material world, and they can fulfill that desire. And then actually some other things came out, like Vishnu's bow, Sharanga came out, Vishnu's conch shell, the Shankha came out, moon, Chandra came out of the churning of ocean. So many important things came out of the churning of ocean. And we did this story because Krishna will say so many things here, that he is Uchchaishrava among horses, or he is, so many things he'll say, that I'm moon among all the, I think we read that already, I'm moon among all the celestial bodies, right? So many things that came out of the churning of the ocean, and those are the supreme things to be, and he's the best in that particular category. So I think we'll continue our reading of Bhagavad Gita, rest of the reading next time. We could only do two verses today, but I think it was important to get our new people up to track on where we are, what we're doing. Is that okay? Would you?
Sounds good, Mataji.
Mataji, I'm sorry we couldn't do your story. Would you? I don't know how long you prepared.
It's pretty short. I have it in my own words, so yes, it's probably gonna take like 7, 8, 10 minutes, maybe less than 10 minutes.
So Nirbhay Prabhu, what do you think? Should we hear it today or next time?
Yes, I think we should hear it. I think, what's the name? Is it Jhilmil or who's here? Bhavani, by the name Bhavani?
Yeah, I think they dropped out before.
Oh, okay. But I think they will enjoy the story.
Okay.
Jhilmil.
What's your name again?
Jhilmil.
Will you type it in the chat box?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Mataji, please start.
Should I go ahead?
Yes, Mataji.
Okay, first of all, my obeisances to all Krishna devotees and pardon my ignorance, my limited knowledge on this. And Natasha Mataji, Nirmal Prabhuji, please feel free to add or correct me on anything. So I'm chanting the story of Vaman and Mahabali, and it's all in my own words though. So just to start out with, who was Vaman? Vaman was the first avatar in which Lord Vishnu was incarnated as a human. And he came in, he incarnated as a dwarf to protect Indra. And Mahabali was the grandson of Prahlad. And Natasha Mataji mentioned before that Prahlad was such, he started learning at the age of 5. He was, he was a very learned person. So Mahabali was the grandson of Prahlad, and Prahlad was the one who taught Mahabali, and he was the son of Virochana. And Lord Mahabali was a great ruler, and people loved him. His teacher was Shukracharya, and Shukracharya was the one who brought Bali back to life with the help of his mantras and power after Lord Indra killed him. And he was a devotee of Lord Brahma too. And he prayed to Lord Brahma to give him all the powers, same powers as Lord Indra, so that he can be as powerful as Lord Indra. And Brahma thought that he was a very righteous man, and he granted his boon. And so with the help of his teacher, Shukracharya, Bali conquered all the three worlds. And when we say about three worlds, the three worlds, and correct me, Natasha Mataji, if I'm wrong. So when we talk about three worlds, I think it is the earth, heaven, and the space between the earth and heaven. Am I right?
Mataji, I think it's earth, like you said, Bhulok. The upper planets or the heavenly planets, there's seven in number, and then lower planets, which are Patal Lokas, various like Bital, Atal, Sutal, Patal. So there are like six lower, then Bhulok, and then seven upper.
Okay. So that's what Bali wanted. Bali soon conquered all the three worlds. And Bali defeated Lord Indra, who was the king of gods, and he took heavens. Bali, aided by his gurus, always thought he was righteous and was very devoted to Lord Vishnu. Then Shukra once called him and said, as if you have conquered the three worlds, you have to perform 100 Ashwamedha Yagnas. And if you perform those 100 Ashwamedha Yagnas, you will always be the king of those three worlds. So Bali now got so excited that, so that I can always be the lord of three worlds, he started performing for the yagnas. And when Lord Indra saw that he was doing that, Indra got very jealous, and he started feeling that all the gods will be on Bali's side, and then they will, so he got really unhappy about that. And one day when he was sitting, Indra's mom asked him, it's like, what's going on, why you look so unhappy, what's going on? And Aditi was Lord Indra's mother, and he told his mom that this is what's bothering me, that Bali is gonna be, everybody's gonna go to Bali, and they're gonna think that he is the god. And so Ma Aditi started praying to Lord Vishnu and started performing yagnas, and then one day Lord Vishnu appeared before Aditi and asked her, like, why are you praying? What's your cause of praying? And she said, you know everything, and Bali has taken over my son's kingdom. So Lord Vishnu interrupted, and she said, Bali is a great man. Everybody loves Bali, and he's a great devotee, and he deserves to be Indra. And Aditi said, I know that Bali is a great king, and but what I'm worried about is the other asuras. They will fail to maintain their, they will fall, and they will maintain their old habits, and they will go back to hurting people. And we don't want that. And Lord Vishnu said to her, okay, I will wish, what do you wish? And Aditi said, I wish that you are born as my son to end Bali's menace. Vishnu smiled and he said, Bali is not a menace, but I will give you what you want. I will be born as your son. And soon Aditi and Kashyap had a son, and he was a black shot boy, and that was Vamanji. Lord Vaman was very intelligent, and he was full of friends. And there, Bali is, I mentioned earlier that Bali had to perform 100 Ashwamedhas to, so that he can still be the king of three worlds. And there he is, he's performing his 99 yagnas. He had already performed 99 yagnas, and he was on to the last yagna. And when he was performing his last yagna, Lord Vamandev came and came to his kingdom, and he bowed down to him. And Mahabali was so pleased to see him. And he was, he came in as a Brahmin. And when any Brahmins came to Mahabali, you know, he was always welcoming them. And he asked him, it's like, what can I do to you? He bowed to him, he washed his feet. And what do you want from me? And he said, like, I will give you anything you want. And Shukracharya, that was his guru, he even interrupted Bali and said, don't say like that. You know, you can, you know, you can't just give everything to him. But that it was Bali. Bali said, no, I'm going to give him what he asked for. And Shukracharya told him, he is Lord Vishnu himself. You know, you may lose everything, but he says, no, I will, you know, I'm going to give him what he wants. So Bali asked Vamana, it's like, what do you wish, sir? And he says, I want 3 steps of land measured by my feet. Mahabali said, is that all you want? And just remember that at this point, what he's thinking that Lord Vaman is just a dwarf. It's just like, he is just a short dwarf boy. So as soon as like, okay, you get everything you want. And as soon as he said, wow, the Vaman grew and grew and grew. He became so huge that he took his first step to the earth. And then he lifted his other leg and measured the skies. And Vama said, I have measured the earth and the sky in 2 steps. Where should I put the 3rd step? You told me that I can have 3 steps of land. Where should I put the 3rd step? And Bali said, my Lord, I'm not here to break my promises. I offer you my head as your 3rd step. And there's just Bali just pushed and he put his 3rd step on Bali's head. And Bali, Mahabali was pushed to the Hatalok. You know, he went to the netherworlds. And that's the whole thing which happened with Vaman and Bali Dev. So Bali Dev, because he was such a big devotee of Lord Vishnu, and he just, whatever Lord Vishnu wanted, he did it. And he went to Patalok. Then when he went to Patalok, Lord Vishnu felt so bad. He was like, he is such a big devotee of me. He's been worshiping me. And now because of me, he is in Patalok. So he decided to go to Patalok and visit him. And there he was, Mahabali, a very happy king. And everybody was so happy in his kingdom. And Lord Vishnu went and asked him, it's like, can I be your security guard? Can I, you know, just protect your kingdom? And so he became his security guard over there, just trying to protect his kingdom there. And everybody was so happy over there. Bali was the king. And then one day, this beautiful woman, she came in and she wanted to serve Bali. And she started serving Bali. And one day she was just praying. And Lord Mahabali asked her, I was like, what are you praying for? And she said, I'm praying for your success, for you, for your safety. And Bali was so happy. And Bali was like, just ask me what you want. And she's like, just bring me my husband back. I was like, how can I bring your husband back? And he's like, no, he's here. He is your security guard in your kingdom. That's my husband. Just bring my husband back. That security guard was Lord Vishnu himself. And the goddess was Lord Lakshmi. And as Miss Natasha, she mentioned back in that churning of milk story, that Lord Lakshmi always stays where her husband as Vedava Lord Vishnu is, and he was, Lord Vishnu was right there. Lakshmi, Lord Goddess Lakshmi came back to get her Lord Vishnu back. And so that's how Mahabali was surprised to see God, that it was Goddess Lakshmi and Lord Vishnu right there. And Lord Vishnu was so happy, and he said, I'll give you your kingdom back. You're going to be the Indra, you know, and I'm just so happy that you worship me all this time, and you made such a wonderful kingdom right here. So this was the story of Lord Mahabali and Vamandev. And if I said something wrong, I'm sorry, but that's what I could get out of it.
Mataji, beautifully recited. Thank you so much.
Mataji, I didn't know the later part, so it's good. I hadn't heard the later part of it.
Yeah, all those details. Very nice.
Thank you for sharing.
Yeah, I didn't know about all of this, how he became the guard and everything. Thank you so much. So the reason this started about Vamandev was because of when Krishna starts talking about his opulences, the first thing he says that I am Vishnu among the, let me see, what does he say exactly? And that was a little confusing to read. Of the Adityas, I'm Vishnu. Yes, of the Adityas, I'm Vishnu. So, you know, Aditi is the mother of all the demigods, right? Diti and Aditi are two sisters. They're wives of Kashyap Muni. And Aditi is the mother of demigods, and Diti is the mother of demons. So Adityas are the sons of Aditi. So Aditya and Surudev is one of the sons. He's commonly referred to as Aditya, but there are many Adityas. There are 12 Adityas. And those are the sons of Aditi. And among them, he says, I'm Vamandev. I'm Vishnu, meaning I'm Vamandev. So that is where the story came in. Okay, I think we have, we're going to exceed our time. If we should chat probably now.
So we ask the new people. Shanmugh, did you understand the story?
Yeah.
Did you like it?
Yep.
Okay. Well, we discuss a lot of stories like this. So you're welcome back next time, next week. We're going to have, many more stories from Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is more of discussing about Krishna. And then Bhagavatam is the book that has a lot of stories in it. So you can, ask your parents to read you from Bhagavatam. They can tell you stories, or we can tell over here the stories from Bhagavatam. And these are real stories that happened in the past. And that's used for us to discuss and learn about God.
Hare Krishna. Okay. Hare Krishna. So let's chant.
And then, sorry, one moment. I want to ask Aman Prabhu. He's here today.
Yes.
So would you like to, how was your experience? Would you like to share your experience and any comments you had? Thanks for coming today.
Me?
Aman Prabhu is here. I think he may have gone. I don't know if he's still available. So I'm talking about him. But yeah, he may be busy right now. So yeah, we can chat and then we can see if he's still available. Discuss afterwards. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Just wanted to say thanks to you for coming and joining our group today. Would you like to tell everybody a little bit about yourself so we know you better?
Yes, Prabhu. So basically, I hailed from Kolkata in West Bengal. I'm a student right now. I'm a first year student. I'm pursuing my BA program from St. Stephen's College, New Delhi.
Okay. So you're joining from Delhi right now, Prabhuji?
No, Prabhuji. I am right now in Kolkata itself because due to Corona, I came back.
Okay.
Maybe Aman Prabhu has joined with us.
Right now, I'm in Kolkata.
Oh, yes. From Ravi Prabhu.
Yes, Mataji. Yes.
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Yes, I know him well. I did.
Actually, Prabhuji, my internals are going on, so I couldn't join previously. And My internals are still going on. It will end the day after tomorrow. That's Monday. There is the last internal.
Okay. Wish you all the best, Prabhuji.
Yes, all the best. No problem. Just join.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Yes. Thank you, Mataji.